Good evening. Meeting 2020. And I am the president of the Northern New England Conference, and I am just so delighted that you have chosen to be with us here live on our conference YouTube channel, which we are kicking off this evening. Our theme for this year's camp meeting is 2020 Vision. I don't know, 10 or 12 years old, and I was at the pediatrician's office, and the nurse at the pediatrician, she had me stand in the hallway and look at an eye chart on a wall across from me, and cover one eye and then the other, read as many of the columns on the eye chart as I possibly could. At the end of that little exercise, she told me 20 vision. Our meeting this year, because it is 2020, is 2020 Vision. And what do we mean by that with 2020 Vision? Well, what we mean in the year 2020, we want to begin to live and see the world as God sees the world. I truly believe that we are end-time Christians living in the closing scenes of this earth's history. And it is vitally important that we pray and ask the Lord God to open the eyes of our heart that we can see the world as God sees the world. I have a few props here with me this evening. The first is a set of World War I binoculars. Binoculars help us see things that are in the distance, correct? They help us see things that are far off. And part of 2020 vision and seeing things as God would have us to see them or as God sees them is being able to see and understand and recognize the signs and know what's coming ahead in the future. And so we want to be able to see the future and know the future. And the only way that we can do that is by a connection with God, because God is the only one who can do that, correct? We can't do that by ourselves. And so we want to see the future as God sees the future. I also have a magnifying glass with me this evening, because as important as it is to be aware of the future and be able to recognize the signs of the times in which we're living, we don't want to become so heavenly focused or so forward focused that we fail to see things right in front of our nose. And that's what our magnifying glass represents this evening. As end-time Christians, as we go about our daily living, we want to be focused not only on the future, but on the immediacy around us. We want to be able to see people and recognize need and opportunity for us to share our faith and share the love of Jesus with those we meet. You know, God doesn't care about a person's ethnicity, their culture, their race, their gender. God doesn't care where you've been or what you've done. God only cares about where he can take you. And as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we are his messengers, his angels, if you will. And he is calling us and asking us to be aware of the people around us. Remember Jesus? He certainly modeled that for us. When he saw Matthew sitting at the tax collector's desk, he didn't just see a tax collector. He saw a young man who needed a relationship with God, who needed a life-changing relationship. Remember the woman at the well? He didn't just see a woman who had had five husbands. He saw a woman who was broken and needed living water and a living connection with the God of the universe. And so, friends, if we're going to have God's vision, if we're going to have 2020 vision, we not only need to see the future, we also need to be aware of opportunity around us. And we need to deal lovingly, kindly, patiently, and graciously with the people that God places in our path. We need to see them as children of God, loved by God, and have an opportunity to welcome them into God's family and God's kingdom. And so I'm excited about our camp meeting this year. This evening, we have a very special guest with us who is going to be joining us via Zoom. His name is Christopher Duffley, and we're going to introduce you to Christopher here in just a moment. Christopher, are you with us?
Christopher, are you there?
Yes, I am. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, Christopher. Welcome to the Northern New England Conference of Seventh-day Adventist Camp Meeting.
Yes, great to be here with you guys this evening.
We are super appreciative that you're here. You and I met a few years ago at Camp Laurelwell, didn't we, Christopher?
Did we? Oh my gosh, that's really?
Yeah, I had the pleasure of meeting you there. I heard you play the piano, and
I do remember that.
I think that you were there for our blind camp, is that correct?
Yes, I was.
And you live in New Hampshire, don't you?
Yes, I do.
And Christopher, tell us, how old are you?
I am 19.
19, and you just had a birthday, didn't you?
Yep, May 19th. Mm-hmm. It's my golden.
That's awesome. Well, all of us in Northern New England want to wish you a happy 19th birthday.
Thanks, appreciate that.
And Christopher, I have just a few other questions I want to ask you to help you get to know the people who are watching you live this evening. Tell me a little bit about some of the circumstances of your birth. You didn't have a regular or a normal experience as most people have, did you?
Part of it got cut off because of the indoors. What was that?
I said, tell us a little bit about the circumstances of your birth and some of the challenges that you faced at birth.
Right. I was born at 26 weeks premature at 1 pound, 12 ounces. And of course there was too much oxygen. And so after that, I basically lost my sight because of that. And it's been interesting ever since. And then at the age of 5, I was diagnosed with autism. I got adopted, officially anyway, at 2.5 in November of 2003. And yeah, they had custody of me though in August of 2002. So yeah.
And it was your aunt and uncle who adopted you, correct?
Yes, it was.
Fantastic. And you're folks, and you're Christians, aren't you? You're Christian people.
Absolutely, we are. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Tell me a little bit about your connection with Jesus Christ. Is he a friend of yours?
I think he is. I sing his praises all the time, especially not just to jam out with friends or whatever, but just as part of my ministry. That's really what I do. Not all the time, especially these days, but certainly a couple of times, like recently, and it's been awesome, and I'm excited to do it again actually this coming week. So
yeah. Fantastic. Tell us a little bit more about your ministry. What does that look like?
So Mission Possible Enterprises is our business, and I basically share my testimony in however long, however lengths and longs they want, pretty much. And part of that, I get to share a song that we'll be playing shortly, Open the Eyes of My Heart. It is just my absolute, it's a very significant song because, as blind people, but also as sighted people, of course, I really hope, of course, we as blind people can't see with our eyes, but, I want all of us to at least try our best, right? To open our hearts to God, because that's really that's literally what we're, you know, that's literally what I you know, I think we should do, because what's that day? Yeah. So.
Well, thank you for that. And Christopher, you've done a couple of albums. Tell me a little bit about those.
Yes. Yeah. So Eyes of My Heart was released in October of 2013, I believe. Yes, it was. And Believer was released in August of 2015. And I'm hoping to have another one in the mix as well. We'll see what happens over time. But yeah, no, it's been an interesting journey, really, over the past, you know, 5 years. Ever since the last album came out, I've actually had a couple of originals that I've helped co-write. No, I'm not the best songwriter ever, but I did help, and you know, it's been quite cool. And and actually, speaking of music, I do hope in the future, and I have done some, but not professionally yet. Although who knows, I do hope to get into recording and audio production. And who knows? Maybe you know. I don't know how much non-Christian stuff I'll do, but we'll see. You know, it kind of depends on the, But yeah, I do hope to get into that in the coming years, a lot more. So yeah.
Certainly wish you the best of luck. Thank you. Our thoughts and prayers, and I hope to see you at Camp Laurelweld next year.
I hope so as well, because that was absolutely a fun time. I mean, yes, you had no service sometimes, but you know, who cares? we had a fun time regardless, I think. So
I tell you what, if we see you at Camp Laurelweld next year, I'll take you out on the lake and let you drive the boat. How about that?
Oh boy, there you go. Yes.
Well, good deal, Christopher. Thank you for being with us. And again, your thoughts and prayers, and we're looking forward to your song, which we're going to play right now.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, guys. Pleasure to be here again.
Thank you, Christopher.
Thank you, Christopher. That is all of our prayer, isn't it? We want to see the Lord. And not only do we want to see him personally coming in the clouds of glory as Seventh-day Adventists, we look forward to that day, but we want God to literally open the eyes of our heart so that we can see him as he truly is, and we can see him reflected in his children and love and embrace them as well. So our theme is 2020 vision for our camp meeting this year. Tonight, I am coming to you live from the campus of the Brunswick Seventh-day Adventist Church. We wish we were in the big tent this evening, don't we? I really wish that I could see each of you face to face, that we could shake hands, that we could exchange hugs, and that we could fellowship in person this evening. Unfortunately, with the pandemic that is sweeping around our continent and around our globe, we are unable to meet in person for live camp meeting. And so this is the next best thing. But I'm thankful that you're here. Let's pause now and have a word of prayer as a conference community. Let's seek God's face and ask that he will open the eyes of our heart. Let's pray together. Gracious Father in heaven, we are so thankful for all of your blessings to us. We're thankful most of all for your love, that you loved us so much that you didn't leave us here alone in this world. You sent your son Jesus to come and live and die that salvation might be ours. And for that, we are eternally grateful. Lord, as end time Christians, we want to order our lives so that we may follow you and live our lives as you would have us to live those lives. And so, Father, we pray that you would open the eyes of our heart, that you would encourage us, that you would inspire us, that as we see not only the future but the present, that our lives will be changed and we will live as you lived, living only to serve others and love others. For that is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. A few weeks ago, I was in Brunswick. Some of you know that I live in Brunswick. I actually live in the Cook's Corner area of Brunswick. And I didn't know this when I moved into my home a few years ago, but I actually have two of you are my neighbors, Ted Crooker and Wayne Harlow. I didn't realize I was moving into an Adventist community until after I bought the house, but it's a joy to have such good neighbors. And I enjoy living in Brunswick and in the Cook's Corner area. And I was recently in Cook's Corner at a business, and I met a gentleman by the name of Tom. And Tom and I were talking, and we were sharing, and Tom told me that he had retired from the United States Air Force. And I said, Tom, that's incredible. What did you do in the United States Air Force? Were you a pilot? And he said, no, Ted. He said, I was in the pararescue division of the United States Air Force. And so I said, well, Tom, what is the pararescue of the United States Air Force? And he said that the pararescue unit are the best trained technical rescue personnel in the entire world. They are trained to solve literally any problem, from emergency medicine, mountaineering, deep sea diving, the use of weapons in combat, to free hostages. And of course, one of the things that they focus on most is search and rescue. If a pilot crashes into the ocean, they send in the pararescue division to find that pilot. And so the pararescue division of the United States Air Force is a very elite group of the people who apply for it. Close to 90% wash out. They only take a very small portion of those who are who apply to be in the pararescue unit. And they have a unique motto. You can see it there on the screen. Their motto is that others may live. They put themselves in harm's way so that other people may live. And as I talked to Tom about that, you know, I thought, boy, there are a lot of similarities between the United States Pararescue Organization, the United States Air Force Pararescue Organization, and end time Christians living with a vision as God would have us live. You know, our mandate, our mission as Seventh-day Adventist Christians is to share the good news of Jesus' soon coming, to share the three angels' messages in the context of the everlasting gospel. And as we do that, we are challenged to share with people our love and our relationship with Jesus Christ in a compelling way so that they too can have the relationship and the opportunity for salvation that God has given us. Our offering for this evening is going to be for evangelism. Every year at camp meeting, our offering is for evangelism. This year, 75% of all offerings that come in marked for camp meeting will be going to evangelism. The other 25% will be going to Christian education and to our schools. The easiest way for you to give is to go onto the NNEC website and AdventistGiving.org, and you can give directly from your laptop computer or your smartphone this evening. And I want to encourage you to give generously and faithfully as God has been generous to you and God has been faithful to you. So again, our offering this evening and all throughout the week will be for conference evangelism as we seek to share the good news of salvation with those around us that others may live. Just like the Pararescue, our mission is to save other people. That's why God has called us to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, not just for our salvation, not just for the salvation of our families, but so that we can go out and spread the good news of what Jesus has done in our life. So I want to thank you for being faithful in your giving and in your support. I know that we're living in very difficult times. If you are facing challenges in your life related to unemployment because of the pandemic that we're experiencing, I want to encourage you to reach out to me. As a church, we are looking for ways to help those who are in need. If you are in need this evening, in need of food, in need of financial assistance, please call the conference office and reach out to me. We care about you. We want to help you. We thank you for being faithful, not only with your time, your talent, but also with your treasure. And so, friends, as we continue to share the eternal and everlasting gospel, and we share the message of Seventh-day Adventist Christianity, I believe that God will bless our efforts. Our message and our mission is too important for it to fail. God will not let that happen. And so as you are faithful in your giving to the Northern New England Conference and to your local church, God will be faithful to you. Thank you so much for your willingness to be faithful. Our speaker this evening is a very good friend of mine. His name is Elder Jim Gilley. Jim was born in Texas, went to Southwestern Adventist University, and then later to Andrews University, where he got his Master's of Divinity degree. Jim started out in ministry in the Southern New England Conference, where he actually planted the Lemonster Church. I've spoken at the Lemonster Church. Some of you are familiar with that congregation, just a few hours south of us. And Jim actually started that church. He became the conference evangelist for the Southern New England Conference. And then God took Jim all kinds of places. Jim has literally done absolutely everything that anybody could possibly do in serving God in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. He has been a part of ASI. He has worked in independent ministries, supportive ministries. That's where I first became acquainted with Jim, when he worked for Coleman Stewardship Services, an organization that I would later work for as well. Jim and I became acquainted there. Jim worked in world evangelism, doing evangelistic outreach to Russia and all around the world. From there, Jim
pastored the Arlington Seventh-day Adventist Church and grew that church from 300 in attendance to over 1,000 in attendance. God has taken Jim Gilley a number of different places. He's been a conference evangelist, a pastor. He's been a vice president of the North American Division, and then later also conference president of the Arkansas-Louisiana Conference. Jim ended his career with 3ABN as the speaker and director of the Three Angels Broadcasting Network. Today, Jim and his wife Camille live in Florida, and the Lord has blessed them with children and grandchildren through their 60 years of marriage. I am so thankful that Elder Jim Gilley agreed to be our speaker for this weekend. Jim is a very good friend, and I want to share my profound thanks that he was willing to present to us this evening. I know that you'll be blessed as Jim shares with you. And at this time, I want to welcome Jim Gilley to the Northern New England Conference and to camp meeting. Let's see what Jim has to tell us this evening.
Gordon, I appreciated that message and song. Well, we're living in some very interesting times, aren't we? Very interesting. Now, we've had periods of anxiety in our nation before, many times actually, but probably the most recent that we who are living here today went all through together would be 9/11. After that, the rest of the year, we were very anxious, thinking there might be another terrorist attack. Now we are anxious, thinking in terms of possibly a return of the COVID-19. Had a discussion this week and talking with a very intelligent individual. And he expressed his concern that we will be facing another bout with this virus later in this year. So that does cause some anxiety, no doubt about it. I got this title, 2020 Vision, from Ted Huskins when he called to ask me to go to the Northern New England Conference to do their camp meeting this summer. And I was looking forward to some really nice, cool Maine weather. I love Maine in the summer. I've told people I love New England summers both days. But the truth is that I really do love that part of the world certain times of the year. And particularly Northern New England is very historic for our church, for the beginnings of this message, for the William Miller movement that took place in 1844, and all of the different things that happened. And I love the Northern New England camp meeting. I've been there several times as a speaker over the years and looked forward to returning. But this time I have to return virtually, because they're not able to actually have an open camp meeting. And so, you know, we just go along with the flow. We reach out and adjust to things and still keep moving forward. But I thought the 2020 vision, you know, if we really truly have the real vision that God gives us, we have a lack of anxiety. We have a trust in Him. We may not know what the future holds, and we really don't. Believe me, we don't. The folks in 1844 thought they did. There was a young girl that was a part of that. Her name was Ellen White. And later she warned to be very careful about unfulfilled prophecy, because we may not understand exactly the way it's going to be fulfilled. Now, I've seen guys with charts, and they have all these things charted out, and they know exactly what's going to happen and the order it's going to happen. My friend, I wouldn't put a lot of faith in those charts. I don't think that young girl, Ellen White, did, as she grew into womanhood and became such a servant of God for this movement. Anxiety. If we really, truly could see the future, we might not be too excited about that. You know, George Beverly Shea wrote a song, goes something like this: if we could see beyond today as God can see, we may be glad that we didn't But if we could, we would have our complete trust, or must have complete trust in Him, that it's all going to end right. May not end right on this earth, may not be end right for me, may not be end just right for you, but in the end, it's going to happen. As somebody used to say, a friend of mine, he said, I've been to the back of the book. I've read in Revelation the story of the victory of God and His people. And so that alone should be something that would help us to get rid of some anxiety, because there is a lot of anxiety today. Now, anxiety is a little different from fear. By the way, all of these emotions, fear, anxiety, etc., all of these have been given to us by God. And in their proper manner, they are very healthy, believe me. It's something that you should have some fear. You should teach a child not to put their finger in a light socket. You just tell them, don't do that. Now, if they do that, they will have learned by experience. But that is not necessarily the best way. And if you can learn without making some of these mistakes, it really is very good for you. But anxiety is a kind of a fear that's underneath. It's not a fear that you act upon. It's a fear of something of the unknown. And it's a condition that takes place. Now, it's not a disease. And some people think it's a disease. Not a disease. It's more of a condition. The normal anxiety is okay. A little bit is very proper. But then when it gets out of control, it begins to do things to us that may be hurting us physically and spiritually. You know, the Lord talks about being anxious. In Luke, the 12th chapter, verse 29, He says, "And do not seek what you should eat, or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you need these things. But seek the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." Now, when you get over to Matthew, he uses the word, "take no thought for tomorrow." Now, take no thought. The King James Version was written in about 1611, which is about the time of Shakespeare. If you remember one of the Shakespeare characters, it says that he died of thought. Now, it didn't mean that he had a thought and it killed him. It meant that he was so concerned and so anxious and had anxiety that it brought about his death. You know, in World War II, between 1940 and 1945, one-third of a million of our young men died in war. 300,000 plus died in war. During that same period of time here in the United States, over 2 million people died with heart failure. And it was estimated that from one-third to one-half of those were directly worrying about the war in Europe. More people died from worry about it and anxiety about it than died from the actual bullets of being on the battlefield. That shows you the danger of living in anxiety, of being caught up in this thing. Somebody says, "But I cannot change my thinking. I've started thinking about something and it just works on me." There's something I've found that works real well, and that is to get your TV changer and then mentally change your channel. Just start thinking about something, even if you have to start worrying about something else. Move your mind away, because you get this groove that's built into your mind and you can't seem to get away from it. And that becomes a very real case of anxiety. Now, that doesn't mean we're not to prepare. Good preparation will actually dispel anxiety. In fact, if you're totally prepared for so many things, you've done everything you can to take care of the things that are in the future, then that will help you to relax and not to worry about some of these things. I remember one time, you know, the Bible talks about making sure that you have the provisions to build a tower once you start it. We were on our tour from leaving Samaria, going down to Jerusalem, and I remember seeing those towers out there. These were towers that the landowners would build so they could climb up and look out over all of their land, and they would be able to see what was going on all over the property that they owned. They might have somebody working over here, somebody planting over there, somebody tending the sheep back here, and they were able to stand on that tower, because those are not like our big farms in Texas and Florida and in the Midwest. They are very somewhat small farms, but they had different sections where the people would be working, and so the landowner could go up in that tower. But those are pretty good towers. And the Lord said, be sure you have enough provisions. Be sure that you're prepared so that you don't run out. So preparation is good. There's nothing wrong with preparation. You know, it's this distracting anxiety that we want to get away from. If you're an administrator, if you can anticipate problems and foresee what maybe makes you a good administrator, but you want to be careful that you don't become so tied up in those things that it makes you anxious. It causes you to have anxiety. You know, the Bible talks about, in fact, we go back up here to verse 24. It says, consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? You know, I think that sometimes we need to become members of the Spiritual Audubon Society. Study nature, study the birds, see how God does take care of them. My wife is a great bird lover. We have some sand cranes here in Florida that stay out behind our house. And we put a little cracked corn out for them, little scraps of things that they like, and they really do enjoy them. In fact, they'll stand and look at us almost like, hey, there's not enough out here right now. Other places we've had feeders for the little hummingbirds. And hummingbirds are very interesting. I did a little study of hummingbirds one time. I found out there were 320 species of hummingbirds. You know, if you look at all these different things, folks, if anybody can look at these things and not believe in a creator, I don't understand that type of reasoning. I really don't. It'd be like thinking that there'd be an explosion in a print shop, and all of a sudden there would be great dictionaries come floating down. You see, it's just about as ridiculous to believe that as to believe in the Big Bang Theory or in some of the theories that you hear today. I believe with all my heart that we have a creator. In fact, I preach a message called A Hill to Die On, and I believe that's a hill that we need to be prepared to die on. But when I look at these little hummingbirds, I looked at one particularly, the bee hummingbird. It's one of the smallest. From the tip of its beak, and its beak's pretty long, to the end of its tail, it's about 2 inches. Weighs about 2 grams. When it does its wings, it can flap its wings 90 times in 1 second. Now, I stood in my study one day and I tried seeing how many times. I was glad nobody came in. I would lock me up. But I was trying to see how many times. Can you imagine 90 times in 1 second? That's amazing. But that something else about this little hummingbird is that he flies from the far north of the United States all the way down to Panama, where he spends the winter. Shows he's pretty smart to get out of the north and head to Panama. But after that, he flies back, and they tell us he flies it nonstop. I don't know who's followed them and made sure they didn't sneak in a stop somewhere, but they claim they flies nonstop all the way back. Now, to me, that's just unbelievable that he would know to go back to his very home. God says, consider the ravens. They don't worry about how they're going to get back. They don't worry about all of the things that we sometimes worry about. And so we need to put things into perspective. We need to think about those things. So, but what are some steps that we can actually take? Number one, you need to analyze your anxiety. You need to, first of all, realize that if you have anxiety. I went through this process one time just on my own, and I thought to myself, there is a certain amount of anxiety in me. Why is it? When did it start? And I began to think back to a carefree childhood. I was absolutely a kid that had no fear of anything, no worry. And then one night, all that changed. That night, my sister, 18-year-old sister, who was almost like a mother to me, was killed in an automobile accident. Ever after that, whenever any of the family was out, my mom and dad could not relax. They could not go to bed until everybody was in. They were anxious. Before that, totally relaxed. After that, realizing that it can happen to us. But somehow that was transferred to me, and I suddenly began to realize that if I didn't have full control of my children, know exactly where they were, that I had this anxiety, that I was concerned about their safety. I still battle a little bit with this. I mean, I'm going to tell you, you don't always get through all of these things immediately. And I'm sharing this with you because you may have something like this that's keeping you from enjoying and happening the grace of God and enjoying that grace and enjoying an experience with Him because you're not able to completely rely upon the Savior. And so I had to begin to work through that. And that's the second thing you need to do. You need to reason through your anxiety. Can you change anything? No, you can change very few things. Now, you can keep your children at home, never let them go anywhere, and then they wouldn't develop. They have to develop and become their own individuals. I have four of the most independent children in the world. They're all adults now, and they have their own children. But they are very independent, every single one of them. And I'm proud of them. I'm so very proud of them. And I don't get me started bragging on my kids today, but I want to tell you something, that it was very tempting to want to control everything that they did. But you see, we cannot always be in control, and we have to let go of some of that control. And that's one of the ways that we dispel this anxiety. And sometimes I have to sit down and talk to myself. And I call myself Gilly. I say, Gilly, I want you to think about this a minute. We're looking at a situation. What is the worst thing that can happen? And can you handle that? And you know, if we can look at the worst possible scenario and then say, Lord, with your help, I can go through that. Then anything that happens in between, you're going to be able to handle. Now, that may not work for you, but it works for me. And third, we really have to accept, and after reasoning through our anxiety, we have to accept the results. We look at it. We look at these things, and then we accept. And we are able to lessen our anxiety greatly. Now, the Bible tells me exactly what we really should be concerned about. It says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. And the greatest way to overcome any kind of anxiety is to do just that. You replace these lesser anxieties with one all consuming go, and that is seeking the kingdom of God. Somebody said, wait a minute, you're adding a greater anxiety to me. No, this is not. Because you must trust and faith, know that you cannot save yourself. You're saved only by the Lord Jesus Christ. But you want to build a better relationship with him. You want to grow with him. And if you seek first this kingdom, as he says, it's not my counsel, it's his. Seek him first. In all of these things, he says, he will add to you. I was talking to a man one time, and he said, let me tell you a key to handling all these things in life. First of all, he says, don't sweat the small stuff. Secondly, he said, it's all small stuff. Now, that sounds good, but my friend, it's not. If your child has leukemia, that's not small stuff. Your child has a brain tumor, that's not small stuff. If your wife is sick and has breast cancer and is in stage 4, that's not small stuff. There are some difficult things to face, but we put them in perspective and rise with the Lord and face them with him. There's a great old preacher, he's written a lot of books, Clovis Chapel, and he lived back in the time when aeronautics was pretty new. He told a story about a pilot. He said that this pilot was taking a plane across a large body of water. And he knew that it was going to take him hours to make it across that body of water. And so he was concerned that he was hearing a noise in the plane. And he finally figured out that a rat had gotten into that little single-engine plane and was somehow back in the control panel chewing on some of the wiring. Now, if you have experience with that, I've had experience with rats chewing wiring and destroying it and putting your, it was in our case, the air conditioner completely out of order. And they can do it. And he knew that there was no way, if that rat got through to that instrument, that he'd be able to make it home, make it across the water. And so the single engine plane did not have oxygen, and he'd been flying at about 4,000 feet. He thought to himself, rats live usually at ground level. In fact, he was surprised he was doing as well as he was doing at 4,000 feet. So he said, I'm going to move up. And he moved up to 6,000 feet, then to 10,000 feet. And finally, he could still hear the gnawing. Finally, he thought, I can't stay up here long, but I'm going to go all the way to 20,000 feet. And he went almost to 20,000 feet before he heard the gnawing stop. When he got to his destination, he opened up the panel, and there was a dead rat. You see, we need to rise above the problems that we face. We need to be with the Lord in the secret of the Most High. We need to be with him, studying with him, praying with him, and thinking about him. And when we do, we'll rise above a lot of the things that bother us. We need to know that God will stand with us, that we can trust him. You know, they tell us that 92% of the things we worry about, you and I are concerned about, never actually happen. And those that do happen, we can have it. We can handle them with Jesus Christ our Lord. A few weeks ago, I shared with our church here in Florida a story. You know, World War II was quite a thing, especially we've been so fortunate here in the U.S. not to have real combat on this soil. These last World War I, World War II, and the Korea and Vietnam conflicts, it was all somewhere else. But those people that lived there suffered greatly. September 1, 1939, Hitler invaded Poland. He'd already annexed Czechoslovakia, Austria, and now he entered Poland. 2 days later, the French and Great Britain declared war on Hitler. And so the real war began. London was just devastated with the flying bombers coming in from Germany, bombing day after day. There was an air raid warden who would go around and help people and tell them that they what they needed to do, take precautions. And he had an elderly aunt that lived in his area. And he would go by and see her, and she had a sign on her wall that says, "Don't worry, maybe it won't happen." And he would point to that wall, that sign, and he'd say, "You know, you need to be worrying." She says, "Well, maybe it won't happen." Well, one night it did happen. And one whole wall of her house was knocked out. That wall was still standing, and that motto was still there, hanging on the wall. And the warden wanted to check quickly on his aunt, and he went by, and he said, "Auntie, it did happen." "Oh," she said, "I forgot to turn that over." And she turned it over, and on the other side, it said, "But if it does, with God, we can handle it." You see, if it does, with God, we can handle it. You know, there are things that are going to that we're going to face. When you look back through your whole life, you'll see how God has brought you through so many things. I don't care who you are. You have had things that you have seen, and you know it's a miracle that God brought you through them. He's going to bring you through the future. 2020 vision means that you're letting God do the looking for you. He is the only one with perfect vision. And so we tune into his vision, knowing that in the end, all things will work together for good. So no matter what happens, know that God will stand with you. And then you need to express the love that God gives you to others. If you really are worried about yourself, you're concerned about yourself, I ask you to do one thing, and that is go and share with others. You'll be surprised what will happen in your own life when you do that. I heard about a doctor, an OB doctor. He had a real macho image. But people who worked with him in delivery said there was something very special about him. When the baby was born, he would take that baby and he would cradle it in his arms. And he would say, "Welcome to our world. God loves you. And everybody in this room loves you. This is a wonderful world. In a little bit, I'm going to put you in your mother's arms. And she loves you. And then she's going to take you home. And they've prepared a nice little place for you in your home. This is a wonderful world. And you are loved." People say they couldn't believe that this macho guy would, one every time he delivered a baby, he went through this with him. You know, we need to realize that we're loved. I've had people say to me, "Nobody loves me." And my first reply to them is, "Do you love anybody else?" Love is a reciprocal thing. I guarantee you, you give out love and you'll get all the love back that you can handle. You treat people with love and care. And you'll have some old sourpusses that'll give you a rough time. It's going to happen. But you will have a lot more people that will return that love to you. You become a doer. This is one way to get rid of some of these problems that we have is to get involved, become a doer, help others. They have a program out at Weimar called TCI, total community involvement. They go out, knock on the door, whole group of kids. What can we do for you? Can we clean your yard? Can we cut your firewood? Can we stack your firewood? Can we clean your house? You just tell us anything that you want us to do, and we are here to do it. No cost, no charge. We just want to help you out. It's had a tremendous response in that community. But you know what the most amazing thing is? What it's done for those kids. Whereas there were a number of kids, like there aren't any group, who were suffering from all kinds of different situations of self-doubt, when they began to get out and to share with others and to give something of themselves, something different happened within them. And they began to actually receive a greater blessing from what they were doing than the blessing that they were doing for others. And then, I have found this to be true. You know, I highly recommend helping people when you can. Now, I know we have to be careful. There are times that you should not put yourself in danger, and I'm not recommending that. Particularly ladies, but gentlemen, there are many times that we can help out with things. When we were living in California, I would drive from my office down in Colfax out to our home, which was near Weimar, about 5 miles. And I would get off at the Weimar Cross exit and head up to Magnolia Ranch Road, which is where we lived. As I would exit there, there was many times people parked there for one reason or another. One time there was a man parked. He had like a box truck, looked like it had been an old U-Haul truck. He was hooked to him, a flatbed trailer. He had a number of outbuildings, little outbuildings, ready-made, pre-made outbuildings that were on there. One was a chicken coop. And so I passed by and I saw him sitting there. And when I went back to my office and I came back, he was still there. So I thought, something's going on. People don't park that long in this place. So I pulled over. I said, "You have a problem?" He said, "Yes, I do." I said, "What's the problem?" He said, "It's my transmission." He said, "I recently rebuilt it." And he said, "I know what the problem is, but I don't have the parts." This was one after another, day after day. Nearly a week he was there. And each day I would stop and visit with him and try to help him along the way. Finally, he got it fixed and went on with his load. You know, I met a very fine man, had a very good time of meeting with him, was able to share some things with him. You see, just because there are problems in the world does not mean that we cannot help out with others. And in this way, it relieves us of so many things. And then we need to concentrate right on the now. You know, right now is the time we live. Somebody has said one time that they were worried about the past, and then the Lord just kind of spoke to their heart and said, "When you live in the past, I am not there because I am not I was. And when you live in the future," he says, "you live all alone because I'm not I will be. But when you live right now, I will be with you because I am that I am. I am the great I am," living right now and concentrating on the now. And then physical exercise. Get out and do some real physical exercise. You'd be surprised how good it is for you. There's not any health program anywhere that doesn't tout physical exercise. It's so important. But most important is the spiritual exercise. And I recommend you making up a list of texts that you read. Read them often. Keep expanding them. I'm going to read some to you right now if you want to write these down. 2 Timothy 1:7, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers." 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter, verse 12. Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 15. "For you have not received
the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. You know, if God's our Father, we don't have to worry about anything else, do we? Hebrews 11:6, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And then Psalms 91:4 and verse 6, he says, he will shall cover thee with his feathers. Under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. And thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence, and that includes COVID-19, that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. Isaiah 43:2. Isaiah 43, one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. And John 14:27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And then, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Psalms 23. My friends, Jesus loves you. He cares for you. And he wants you to love and to care for others. You know, John Scriven, the great pastor, was sick and in the hospital. And a musician by the name of Charles Converse came to see him. And he was a good friend. They were good friends. And Charles said something to John, and John said, oh, that reminds me of something in the Bible. And he reached for his Bible. When he did, a paper fell out. Charles picked up that paper, and he read the words, to what a friend we have in Jesus. John said, oh, just throw that in the trash. That's just something I wrote some time ago. Charles said, oh, no. This is a message that the world needs to hear. And he put it to music. And what a friend we have in Jesus became one of our most loved hymns. Because truly, when you have a friend like Jesus, you can face tomorrow. He has the 2020 vision. We don't, but he does. And he knows your future. He knows my future. We're in his hands, and we can trust him. Father in heaven, we thank you that we can trust you. We can trust your son, Jesus. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, Father, we know that we can face the challenges that we face today in this world. Father, I pray that you'll be with us. I pray that you will lead us, that you will guide us, and that you will direct us, that you will relieve anxiety in our lives, that you will help us to focus upon you and your word and your promises. And I thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name, amen.
That was a fantastic message by Elder Gilley, wasn't it? Thank you so much for being part of our opening night of Camp Meeting 2020. As we are, during this Camp Meeting season, pursuing 2020 vision, which is God's vision. And so our prayer, dear friends, this evening is that the Lord will open the eyes of our heart and that we will begin to see the world as God sees the world. When we see the world the way God sees it, our anxiety goes down and our sense of faith and hope and trust begins to go up as Elder Gilley so eloquently told us this evening. And so, friends, I'm praying that we can see the world the way God sees it, that we will see ourselves as God sees us, beloved, cherished, perfect in His sight. That's how God sees you this evening. Do you believe that? See yourself as God sees you. And then finally, as you look at those around you, begin to see them through the eyes of God. See the checkout girl at the grocery store and the gentleman who picks up your trash at the corner every week. Begin to see the people that you meet as God sees them. They are beloved as well, cherished in God's sight. That helps us to remember that if we're really going to love God, we've got to love His children and love those around us. And so, friends, I'm praying this evening that through this camp meeting season that God will remind us once again to see the world as He sees it, that we will see the events of the future, we'll have an eye on the future, recognizing that He holds it in His hands. We'll have an eye on the things around us, recognizing that God is love and that He loves all of His children. Tomorrow morning, we do not have a camp meeting program per se. We wanted to reserve the 11 o'clock hour for the local church. Many of you are meeting again in person, and we felt like that you would probably prefer to do that rather than have a virtual camp meeting experience. However, if your church is not meeting or you don't have a virtual worship service at your local church, we want to invite you to tune back in here to the conference YouTube channel at 11 o'clock tomorrow. We'll be showing the Brunswick Seventh-day Adventist Church's worship service. Pastor Nathan Stearman, the pastor of the Brunswick Church, will be speaking tomorrow, and you are more than welcome to tune in and be a part of the Brunswick Church worship service at 11 tomorrow. But tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we'll be back again. Elder Gilley has another message for us, and we hope and pray that you'll join us and continue this camp meeting experience with us. Let's pray together as we close, dear friends. Gracious Father in heaven, we are just so thankful this evening that You love us, that You love us so much that You created us, that You love us so much that You couldn't bear to live without us, and You sent Jesus into this world to redeem us. Gracious God, we are thankful for that this evening. And this evening we also pray, Lord, that You will give us 2020 vision, that You'll open the eyes of our heart, that we'll begin to see ourselves as You see us. When we do that, we find our anxiety going down and our faith going up. Lord, we also pray that You will give us 2020 vision, that we can see our neighbors as You see our neighbors, that we will be patient with each other, that we will be kind and merciful to one another as You are kind and merciful to us. Thank You, Lord, for our great conference, for each of our churches, our pastors, our teachers, for each and every member. May You bless us each one. Prepare us for Your kingdom, now and forever, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Good night, everybody. Have a good night's rest and enjoy the rest of your Sabbath. May the Lord bless you.